We are going to look at separation of mixtures. We've learned earlier that mixtures are the physical combination of two or more substances. In today's lesson, we are saying that separation of mixtures involves the separation of the individual components that form the mixture. The separation, for it to be able to, for us to achieve that, is based on the physical properties of the components, such as the boiling point or its solubility in a particular solvent. In trying to separate mixtures, there are certain properties that must be taken note of. One of these properties, which we are going to look at, so we are saying that the physical properties used for separating mixtures. For every mixture, you would have to look at one or two of these properties, which would guide you on which method to use. So the first point is the melting point, the boiling point, the solubility, the temperature difference, the particle size, the density of the substances, and not the least, the weight of the substances. Based on these properties, we have various methods that are employed to achieve the separation of these mixtures. The physical methods used for separating mixtures are simple distillation, fractional distillation, filtration, evaporation, sublimation, magnetization, separating funnel, crystallization, decantation, chromatography, sieving, sedimentation, and precipitation. Do not forget to subscribe to this channel, Dogbert Science Channel. Now we are going to look at some of these methods used in separating mixtures. The first one is simple distillation. Simple distillation is a method used to separate components of a mixture which contains two mixable liquids, such that they boil without decomposition and they have sufficient difference in their boiling points. So let us look at an apparatus of the simple distillation. When we look at the apparatus, there are certain features that are shown. So you have the retort stand with a clamp, and the setup is placed on the tripod stand with the Benson burner beneath it. We have what is called a round bottom flask, and we have the thermometer. In some of the simple distillation apparatus, you won't find a fractionating column, but in this particular diagram we have one here, but it is not found in all cases when it comes to simple distillation. We have a cork that is going to hold in place the thermometer. Then we have the condenser, the water condenser, also known as the water jacket, where water is allowed in and out of the condenser. So here the mixture that was being separated is a mixture of acetone and water. The acetone is having a lower boiling point than the water. In some cases we use alcohol and water, so alcohol is also having a lesser boiling point compared to the water. So upon heating the setup, in the mixture the substance that is having a lower boiling point evaporates first, and it passes through this column and then comes out through this delivery tube. But it is the vapor that is coming through. When it comes to this location where we have the condenser, it converts the vapor back to liquid, which eventually flows out and is collected in this flask. So basically that is how it is. Let us look at some common features of the simple distillation. The features are a thermometer, and we have the need for a thermometer to be able to read the temperature at which the volatile liquid boils. We also have the condenser or the water jacket, and its role is to cool down or condense the vapor to liquid. We have the Benson burner. This is also to provide constant source of heat for the distillation process. So when that is able to take place, we will have the collection of the substance here. The substance that is collected in here is called the distillate. And so an example that we looked at here is acetone and water. We have water and alcohol or any other. Now this is representing a simple distillation where we have only two substances involved in the mixture. In our next part, which is part two of this lesson, so this is part one, we're going to continue from looking at a complicated form of the distillation. But remember to subscribe to the channel as we move on to look at the next point or the next part of distillation and other forms of separation of mixtures. You are welcome back for the continuation of our lesson. The next form of distillation is the fractional distillation. In fractional distillation, you have more than two components that must be separated. And a typical example of such a mixture is the crude oil. So here, this is just a typical diagram for the separation of crude oil into its various components. The various components that we see, we have gasoline or petrol, kerosene, diesel, fuel oil, lubricating oil. And here, these are the temperatures at which they boil. And so as they pass through at that temperature, when they are condensed to that particular product. So here we have what is called a fractionating column, and that is why we call it the fractional distillation. So whether fractional distillation or simple distillation, the principle is to separate miscible liquids which are having different boiling points. Let's now look at the application of distillation in our daily lives. One, distillation is used to obtain local gin, also known as akpeteshi, and whiskey. It is also used to obtain distilled or pure water. Last but not the least, it is used to separate crude oil or petroleum into useful fractions such as petrol, kerosene, gas oil, liquefied petroleum gas known as LPG, lubricating oil, diesel, etc. So once again, if you have not yet subscribe to the channel, the Dogbert Science channel. Let's go on and look at another form of separation, which is filtration. Now, filtration is a method used to separate insoluble particles from liquids using filter paper. It is also used to separate a mixture of two substances where one is soluble in water. So take note, it is used to separate an insoluble solid from its solvent. So the solute doesn't dissolve in the solvent. And we use filtration where filter paper is used. Examples of mixtures separated using this method are a mixture of gari and excess water, mixture of salt and sand, etc. Let us now look at the typical feature of a filtration apparatus. So a filtration apparatus will have the retort stand with a clamp. Here we have the funnel, and in the funnel is placed the filter paper. So you fold the filter paper and place it in. The content of what you want to separate is in the beaker here, and it is poured into the filter, into the funnel, having the filter paper. Beneath the funnel is the beaker which collects the substance that is being separated, and here that is the solvent material. The material collected in the beaker is what is known as the filtrate. The solid material left in the filter is called the residue. Okay, So that is basically the feature of it. Let us now look at the application of filtration. So, application of filtration. It is used by water companies to purify water for domestic use. It is also used to produce pure juice from fruits in fruit cannery. It is used in breweries to remove solid particles from beer or other non-alcoholic drinks before bottling. And it is also used in chemical industries to filter precipitate from their liquid chemicals. Let's look at another example known as evaporation. Evaporation is used as a separation method to separate components of a mixture with a dissolved solid in a liquid. So here, the solute dissolves in the solvent, and we are going to use evaporation to separate these two components. Once you start heating and the liquid is completely evaporated, the solid is all that is left behind. Let us look at a typical example of that. So to be able to do that, you need an evaporating dish. And then you have your mixer in here. When it is heated with a Bunsen burner, the evaporation will take place of with the water coming up, and then what is going to be left is the solid particles beneath it. So here they are using salt and water. You can also have it in this form, and it is the same thing. Application of evaporation. It is used to obtain commercial quantities of salt from seawater. So you go to Adan, you go to salt pump. That is what they use, or the method used. It is also used to preserve food. So that is also there. Now, we'll be moving on to part 3 of this lesson. And do not forget to subscribe to the channel, Jogbet Science Channel, if you have not yet done so. In a jiffy, you move on to the next, which is the part 3 and continuation of this lesson. Welcome to the continuation of our lesson on separation of mixtures. We are going to start by looking at sublimation. We have defined sublimation as the process by which a substance changes directly from the solid state to the gaseous state. Now, the substance that is able to sublime is called the sublimate. Like we said, we use the properties of the individual substances involved in a mixture to separate the mixture. So in this instance, if you have a substance like ammonium chloride, naphthalene ball or camphor, iodine crystals, dry ice and sulfur, you can use this method to separate it from the other forms of mixture. Now, so here is a typical example of ammonium chloride and salt being separated. So we have the apparatus, we have the evaporating dish, we have the tripod stand, we have the Bunsen burner, and we have an inverted funnel where a cotton wool is placed at the end of it. So in the course of heating this mixture, the ammonium chloride vapor rises up. As it rises up, it is collected at this location of the funnel, which is later on collected in a different container. Let us now look at separating funnel. Now here, it is used to separate substances that are immiscible and they are liquids. and one is also denser than the other. Now, due to the differences in their densities, one of the liquids will settle below the liquid of the other one. So we can use it to separate mixtures like water and petrol, oil and water, lubricating oil and soup. So let's look at the apparatus for that. As you can see on the screen, this is a typical example of a separating funnel with a cork here, with a tap here, where the mixture is placed in here. So the mixture is allowed to settle, and then the heavy liquid substance is beneath it, and then the lighter one is there. So you bring in a beaker here, and then you open the tap. This one will flow out when you get to the point where they meet, and then you close the tap, you put the other one beneath it again, then you collect the lighter liquid. So this is a typical example where water and kerosene oil are being separated. Let's look at the application of it. So we use it in the cooking oil industry from immiscible liquids. We use it in separating palm oil and coconut oil in the course of production of them. Another method of separating of mixtures is the crystallization. Now, this process of obtaining pure substances from their pure salt solution. You know, for example, how we extract salt from the sources that we know in Ghana. They may contain some other impure substances. So we want to get, if it is sodium chloride that we want to have, we get that exactly the pure one. So we use the method of crystallization, in that every salt has a specific temperature at which it crystallizes. So it will crystallize early, and then by virtue of the method known as filtration, we will use it to separate it at that particular temperature. So it is used to separate substances from their aqueous solutions. So this is a typical example. After the crystals have been formed at that particular temperature, you undergo the process of filtration to separate it. Now, application is used, the application of crystallization is that it is used in the sugar industry to obtain crystals of sugar. Now, it is also used to obtain salts such as alum and common salts. A very interesting example of method of separation of mixtures is the chromatography. Now, chromatography comes from the word chroma, which means color, and we know that colors are mixed from two or more different primary colors to obtain a particular color. So in chromatography, we are trying to find out the exact colors that were mixed together to form that particular color. So it is used to separate mixtures of pigments such as chlorophyll, ink, dyes, and all those things. So it is used to separate solutes from solution by taking advantage of their different rates of movement in a solvent over an absorbent material or paper. Now, a common example is the paper chromatography. So here we have it. We have the paper chromatography. This is filter paper. Then you indicate the location on the strip of the paper, and you put in your material such as ink. And then you must also know the solvent that might be available for that particular type of material. So you put the solvent in there, and then you place it. So the place you put the ink on the filter paper must not come into direct contact with it, with the water. And as you have made up the setup, by what we know as capillarity, the liquid substance will rise up through the filter paper. So in the course of movement, it will carry along with it the various colors, and as it moves along, then the colors will now become distinctly made on the filter paper, where you can now see that this particular color and this particular color were mixed together to form that particular color. So here you have like the blue color, the orange color, the yellow color, so it was used to come out with those things. So at the end of the day, you are able to tell that these are the colors that were mixed together to form that particular color. Let's come to what we know as decantation. Now, this is another form, more or less, of filtration, but it's a very simple method because you use you just allow the substance to settle down by itself, and then pour off the liquid out from it. So it is used to separate insoluble heavy particles from a liquid. Now it is an alternative to filtration. So basically, this is how you see the substance being separated. The solid particles are here, the liquid substance are here, and then you pour it off. So let's go to a very critical example known as centrifuging. Now centrifuging is using a rotational method of the machine to rotate at a very high speed. Now it is used to separate very fine insoluble solid particles from their liquid. Now one of the interesting things that we should know is that it is used to separate blood into its various components, because blood is made of the solid and the liquid part. The liquid part is the blood plasma, the solid part is the blood, red blood cells, white blood cells, blood platelets, and we want to use that to get the exact component of the blood. So we use this method to separate, and this is how the setup looks like. So this rotates at a very high speed, and the blood samples are placed in there, so you can see those spots in there. So they are placed in there and then subjected to a very high speed. Now when that is done, this is a typical example. So this is the beginning of the experiment, and then at the end of the experiment the particles will settle down where you can distinctly see the various components. So this use, so for example, you may be asked to go for a blood count, and so this is how it's done. So these machines are found in the laboratories where we go for lab tests. Now winnowing is a method that is used to separate two different substances which have greater densities among themselves. So you have been practicing some of these things at home. So it is used to separate this thing, and the mixture is tossed in the air, and then the air current grows, they carry the less dense substances away. So let's go to precipitation. Now precipitation, here there are very stubborn particles that will never settle. So you find a way of making them subdue, and in so doing you add some chemical to the substance which will cause those solid particles to now finally settle down. And so precipitation, that is what is done, addition of chemicals to separate a solute from a solvent in a solution. The solute precipitates from the liquid, which is then hot filtered. Now one method that we are looking at now is the magnetic separation. Now in magnetic separation, one of the substances is is able to get attracted to a magnet, while the other one may not be. So you use that property of one of the substances to separate it. It is used to separate two substances, one of which is attracted by a magnet. Example, iron filings can be separated from sulfur using the magnetic method, as you can see on the screen. So we are ending here, and you are reminded to subscribe if you have not yet done so, and you wait forward to see more of our videos on the channel. Visit the channel as often as you can to learn more. Have a nice day.